Okay, so the public is becoming sparse. I hope everyone will still follow the class later and do the practicals, because it's what I expect in the project. But anyway, so let's start this class with the first topic, which is visualization. So we will discuss about two things today: visualization and some notion of associativity or homophily in networks. So the first one is network visualization. So I have shown pictures of networks many times in the class, and I never really explained what it was. And actually, it's kind of important to interpret it, because if you don't really know what you're seeing, well, it's hard to interpret it. So the question is, what does the position of node means? And can we draw conclusion from the drawing alone? Can I see a picture? Can I say, okay, there are communities, because I see that there are some clusters. So when we want to do a visualization, we can do it using some random layout, of course. So you just put your nodes at random in some space, and then you draw the edges and you look at your network. So obviously it's not really useful as long as you have more than 5 or 6 nodes. Another way to visualize it that we have done in the last class is using a geographical layout. So basically, well, I say geographical, but I mean any kind of special layout in which you put your nodes at some position which corresponds to some property of the node. So of course, the most obvious one is to use a geographical position. So I put the nodes, for instance, here for countries or for airports or whatever. You use this position, and then you draw the edges, and you see that, yeah, it can help you to see some patterns, like maybe there are many, it's very dense from here to there, and maybe less dense from here to there. But of course, with the eye, you cannot see if it's proportional to the number of possible edges or these kind of things. But nevertheless, it can help you to see some patterns in the data. Not that, well, you can also do it with other properties, like, for instance, age or whatever. You put your nodes on some, here, for instance, one-dimensional circular layout, and then you draw your edges between them. And it can also help you to see, for instance, if you have many connections which seems to be short, well, maybe you can try to interpret it, and it can help you to visualize it. But of course, that's not what we are using most of the time. Most of the time, if we don't really know where to put our nodes, we use some automatic layout. And one thing to understand, of course, is that these layouts are not deterministic. So if you run them several times, they will lead to different results, unless your graph is very simple and has a very simple solution for some algorithm. And the general idea is that they try to arrange the nodes so that it's easy to read and to understand. So the first method originally, we were trying to minimize edge crossing, so not make edge cross each other. But actually, that's pretty hard to do, and it doesn't really help most of the time. So more simply, what we are trying to do with modern techniques is to put connected nodes close, and the ones which are not connected far away. And then you have to define what close and far away means. So for instance, here you have an example of the same network, which is plotted using different layouts. And you see that the same network might look different. So you might have a different ID of your graph. For instance, one thing that is sometimes hard or easy to see is these nodes. You see, they kind of form a special group, because they are like connected to the rest only with these four edges. And you can see it pretty well on this layout, maybe also on this one, although it's quite small, but you cannot maybe see it as easily with other ones. So just to say that there are some part of the organization that of course are not very easy to see depending on the layout. So how do we do this optimization? Well, this positioning of the node. Usually we use some variant of the force directed layout. So the idea is that you have a physical system. It's a physical system of bodies. So your nodes are bodies, and you have strength, you have forces acting on them. Okay. You have to define those forces, obviously. And then your objective is to minimize the energy of the system. So you will try to find a position in which the force are balanced. And for instance, we have seen in Gephi the Frösch-Thälmann Rheingold layout. Well, the idea is that you have springs and repulsive forces exactly like that. But yeah, they define spring, I think, like with an analogy to electric systems. And then you have Kamada Kawai, that is also in Gephi, in which you have springs also, but then you take into account the length in the graph as compared to it. I will show you the equation just later. And then another example is Force Atlas, also in Gephi. And this one is a little bit more complicated because it was been designed really to be used in Gephi, so it allows to tune some parameters, as you have seen, like low to avoid overlap and other things which are a little bit specific. Yeah, all of them. So this is what I described. And often you also add some minimal and maximal distances so that you don't put nodes on top of each other and so that the connected components do not drift away. So I think you have seen this in some of plot. If you use Gephi, sometimes some part of the network disappear because it goes out of the drawing. So you have to. So yeah, it's a common problem. So here is an example of what Kamada Kawai is trying to do. So it's actually very simple. It says that the force between two nodes is defined as the distance in the plot, in the drawing, that distance in the drawing, minus the distance in the graph, where d is the distance in terms of number of hops. So basically, what this tells you is that if they are at distance one, they are very close, then they should be close also in the drawing. And if they are more far away than in the drawing that they should be in the graph, then they will be attracted to one another. This will become positive. And if, on the contrary, they are too close compared to what they are in the graph, then this force will become negative, and they will be they will try to go far away from each other. And then you just define your energy of the system like this, and you try to minimize this. Try to make the position of the node in agreement with the position in the graph. So then you just have to use an algorithm. So a naive one will be that while you have not converged, for each node, you compute the forces on it and you update the position accordingly. For instance, for each node, you take it and you say, okay, if I am pulled more on the right than on the left, then I moved a little bit on the right. And you continue to do that until you reach some stable point. And sometimes you don't. That's why in Gephi, you know, it's continued to move and nothing is trying to work and the processor is 100%. Well, because it cannot manage to find a way to get them in a stable position. And the problem with this approach, naive approach, is that repulsive forces are among all pairs of nodes. So, you know, you have to compute this distance in the graph for all pairs of nodes. So you can do this once. But then you have to compute the position between the node in each step and to compute the difference between the two. So, and you have to do this for all pairs of nodes. So of course it's very costly to do that and to do that every time, because the idea here is while not converged. So you have to go through all nodes and then start again, all nodes and so on and so forth. And it's actually between all pairs of nodes. So every pair of nodes and so on and so forth. So, well, it's not really important, but just that you get an idea. So the way to solve this is to do some multi-scale computations. So when you have body system like this, instead of computing the exact values of the attraction to every node, for instance, this is for the red node. So if you do it really like you should, then you should compute your repulsion and attraction to all the other nodes in the graph. But in fact, what you could do is just to compute it exactly for the nodes which are close from you. And then the more you go far away, the more you compute some average value. Like you take all these nodes and you know that, well, it's not really important if it's this one or this one that attracts you. The important is the general position. So you kind of compute what is the general attraction of all these nodes towards you. And this is enough to pull you in one direction or another. Okay, so this is the most used approach and the one you have used in Jeffy or within the NetworkX package. But recently there are some other approaches, for instance, that have been proposed because it's a very popular way to handle graphs currently with using graph embedding. So graph embedding is just mechanism to embed some property of the graph into some small d-dimensional space with d small. And if you want to draw a graph, well, you want to put your nodes in a two-dimensional space. So this is a pretty small dimensional space. And that's what graph embedding try to do. So it's actually pretty close. Actually, we could say that Kamada Kawai, as I presented, is also a graph embedding approach, which looks like some embedding approaches that have been proposed more recently. But the idea is that you can take any notion of distance that you like and not only the number of hops. Maybe you can, for instance, take the probability to reach using a random walk, which will take into account the number of way you have to reach a node from another. You can integrate some other IDs like communities. You can first compute your communities using Lugan and then say that, okay, my distance, for instance, if I'm in the same community, then I will compute my distance in one way. And if I'm not, I compute in another way. And this will try to put communities into your drawing, for instance. So this is really a general approach, general idea that you will compare, you put your distance in the space that you're drawing and the distance in that you have defined on your graph to say if two nodes are similar or not. And there are even approaches also proposed using deep neural networks, for instance. So for instance, here it's kind of an approach based on a generative adversarial network, so on GAN. And just to show you, the idea is that they take several layouts that exist. They plot a bunch of graphs with them, and then they try to generalize what the position of node means. And then, like maybe you have seen these pictures that generate fake faces. You know, they generate faces that of people that do not exist, and they do this by and you can tune this face by tuning some parameters. So you go from one type of face to another type of face using these parameters. And here, that's what they do too. Like they go from one layout to another layout that exists. Using some interpolation. So they try to generalize the ID which is present in all these networks. And so this is a nice way, I think, to understand that, yeah, you have really many different ways to represent a same network, as you can see. And in some of them, maybe you will see very well the structure. For instance, here, the red on the bottom are very well separated. But then this kind of visualization will not see you this as clearly. And other ones will really concentrate on. So you can see that it captures some different properties. And so, yeah, so it's the question of how to represent a node is really not a simple answer, but just, you know, you have to choose a solution that is coherent with what you trying to do. So this leads me to the next question. Can we interpret a force directed layout? Can we interpret this kind of layout? Well, sometimes the answer is yes. So you can see that, for instance, this is a visualization of political blogs with, so the position depends only on some automatic layout. And then the colors are added and correspond to political opinion. So if they are liberals or conservative or in the middle. And what you can see is that, yes, in that case, the layout has very well captured the organization of the network. You can very well see that they are quite separated, and it gives you an intuition on the polarization of opinions, these kind of things. This is an example of high school classes of students in a school. And yeah, you can pretty well see here. So the colors again correspond to the real classes. And this is an automatic layout. And yeah, you see that all the nodes that are in the same class, all the students are in the same class, they look very, they are very close in the network. So yes, clearly the layout really helps you to understand how the network is organized. But of course, the answer is also no, because in many cases, as you have seen in the experiments, it's very hard to interpret what you get. So maybe in that case, you see that, well, you see that you don't see anything, basically. There are these circles, kind of. So you maybe there is a center somewhere, and then all the other one are like a star organization, but maybe not. And here you really don't see anything. Well, it's really a mess. We call that a hairball network, and it's useless to visualize it in this way. So maybe you need to do some preparation, like remove edges that are not important or something like that. But in that case, you see that the layout is not efficient. Another thing that you need to be careful of also is interpreting. So like this example, if you look at these two graphs and you have some, you try to interpret in terms of organization of the graph, and maybe you want to say from this one that it's kind of a hierarchical organization. You have someone in the center, and then you have these three nodes around them, and they are like the periphery. And in this case, it's more egalitarian. Everyone has the same position. Everyone is replaceable by everyone. But of course, these two graphs are exactly the same. It's just the way you draw it that changed the position. And these are kind of position that could be obtained using a force-directed layout. Well, this one should not get here, but if you put it in the middle, it's kind of equilibrate way of representing the graph, so it might stay in that position. Okay, any question on graph drawings? No. Okay, so let's go to the second topic, which is on assortativity and homophily. So what's new in this class compared to the previous one is that we introduced the notion of having an attribute on your node. Until now, we were just looking at graphs with only topology and no attributes. So there is a common saying. So in English, it's birds of a feather flock together. In French, you might say qui se ressemble s'assemble, maybe. And the idea is that, in general, for instance, in social network, people who are alike, they tend to befriend, or they try to have connection. It kind of helps to create connections. And this in a network can be formalized as a way, as a correlation between the vertex at the two endpoints of an edge. So so this picture, for instance, the vertex property can be anything. And a commonly cited example is this one, in which you have a social network in high school, in which nodes are colored by ethnic group. And it's in the US, so you can more easily do this kind of studies. And what you can see is that it's very well structured. The yellow nodes, they tend to connect mostly to yellow nodes, and the green one tend to connect mostly to green ones. Of course, there are connections between yellow and green, and you have also these reds that seems to not really be part of this segregation. But nevertheless, here you see clearly some non-random factor. So maybe you want to quantify this. So one important thing about homophily is that you need to be careful when you interpret it, and in particular when it's something in which it's not a property, an intrinsic property of the node, but something that can change, that can evolve. And this is, for instance, political opinions. for instance, so when you just see one graph at a particular state, you cannot know if what you observe as homophily is the fact that people get connected because they had similar opinions, which can happen, for instance, if people join a political party organization, they join it. So because they will create connection with people because they have the same political opinion, basically. But there is also the opposite that, for instance, inside the family, if you are connected because you are the child or the cousin or some or of someone, then maybe this might affect your political opinion because of many reasons. So when you see the network and you see there is this bias, you have no idea at the beginning if it comes from people connecting because they are similar or people becoming similar because they are connected. So beware the interpretation. Of course, if the attribute is really intrinsic, it's a little bit different. So yeah, the way to differentiate these two cases is to look at the dynamic. If you have access to the dynamic, then you can see if people change opinion because they are connected or the contrary. So of course, when you have homophily, which is possible, but there is also, of course, the opposite effect, which is disassortativity or heterophily. And in English, you say opposites attract, and in French, it's basically the same. A good example of that is, for instance, a graph like this one of sexual or sentimental relationships. So here you have blue node and pink nodes, and they tend to connect from pink to blue. It's not a bipartite network because, of course, you have connection between pink and blue in this graph. But there is a tendency to have more edges between pink and blue. So clearly, in this case, there is some heterophily. But nodes tend to connect to other nodes with a different color. This another example is a predator-prey network, or you have many other types of examples like this. So to quantify this property, you can do it with two kinds of attributes, ones which are categorical or scalar. So just as a reminder, categorical means that you cannot rank them, you cannot sort them and say that one is more different than another, while with scalar ones, you can compare them, like age, weight, income, degree, then it can be discrete or continuous, but in any case, you can rank them. And in this case, you cannot rank them. So if you have categorical attributes, you can compute this homophily in that way. And this means basically that you're counting the fraction of edges between nodes with same attributes. So you count how many edges are between nodes with the same attributes here. And you remove this part, which actually corresponds to the expected fraction of edges between the same attributes. And then you normalize this by saying that, basically the maximal value here can be one, right? If all the edges are between people with the same attribute, then this is equal to one. So what you have on the denominator is that this maximum value minus this, which is equal to this. So this is the maximum value you can get, and you check the value you have, how many edges you have among all the possibles between the people with the same attributes. And so, of course, the value is equal to one if you have a perfect associativity, it's equal to zero if there is absolutely no associative mixing. So this maybe remind you of something. We have seen something which is pretty similar in the class before. Do you have any idea? Not exactly the same, but at least this part is the same. No, well, yeah. Yes, exactly. So this is here. So there is actually just a very simple relation between the assortativity and the modularity. You just the modularity is actually, so the assortativity is the modularity with a different normalization. So the two notions are quite similar. They were, of course, invented by different people for different reasons. So that's why they are different. But you could use assortativity to optimize by considering that communities are attributes in the nodes. So just to clarify the way you compute this, for instance, here with blood types, you compute here the fraction in each cell. You have the fraction of the edges which are between every pairs of blood types. And here you count the number, the fraction of edges inside your inside the in the diagonal, so between the nodes with the same blood type. So you count this plus this plus this plus this, gives you the fraction of edges inside. And then you remove, so every time the expected is just this squared. So this sums to one, and this tells you that if it were random, if you have 0.5 here and 0.5 here, if you will expect to have 0.5 squared here. So you remove this, and then, as I explained, you put one here because it's the maximal possible value, and here your value is given, and then you compute this and you get your score. So in that case, I can say that yes, in this network, whatever it represents, there is some bias, there is some assortativity. There is some assortativity or homophily between the people with similar blood types. And then you can do the same thing with numeric attributes. The idea here is that you can just formalize it as the Pearson correlation coefficient. So if you know it, you know what it represents. It's the most common measure of correlation. You can measure your Pearson correlation coefficient between nodes at the two extremities of every edge. So basically, you have to draw this this plot, this plot in which you have. So in this case, it's a husband and wife, but it should be like spouse one and spouse two if you want in a spouse relationship, and each dot corresponds to one edge. And then you should put them in the in this way. So you have each dot corresponding to one edge, and what the Pearson correlation coefficient tells you is that if it's in average, it looks like a straight line, then there is a correlation, and if it does not, there is no correlation. So in the details, it looks like a little bit like the previous one in the sense that you will compute the fraction of edges inside for each pair of values of attributes. So here it's defined in a discrete way, but for instance age and for each pair of values like edge 2 and edge 20, you will compute how many connections there are. You will remove the expected number of connections, and then you multiply by the values themselves. That's where the difference is, that in this case, you take into account how far these two values are, okay? And then we divide by the standard deviation. So this is just the definition of the Pearson correlation coefficient. But note that if you prefer some different value notion of correlation between values, you can use another notion of correlation. There is no problem. And you just represent it on that way, and then you can use it. In that case, observed in the graph, because it's a distribution of these values themselves. So in that case, you have So in that case, A and B are different, but actually, if you have just one property, it's the same. Okay, so this is a normal definition, which is used by many people, but there are some limits with it. And in particular, one which is, has been more recently, well, some became popular recently. So I will check. Okay. So yes, X and if it's on the last previous slide, yes, X and Y. No, I'm not sure. Sorry, I'm not sure if it's. Well, you can ask the question on Discord maybe, and I will try to answer it later. So the network is so the problem is that in some cases the way nodes are connected, if it's homophilic or not, is different in different part of the network. So for instance, here they looked to a social network, and they look at the relation between gender in this social network. And what they observed is that, it's very small, but that's not that important. It's just a figure from the paper, which is cited here. You can go there if you want. You have the reference in the cheat sheets. So in some part of the graph, they observed that it's mostly assortative. And in some other one, it's not. So why? Because maybe, for instance, some part of the network will correspond to, I don't know, like, on Facebook, you can have like some groups with people who join because they want to like a dating website, for instance. And on the other one, it's groups which are more gender specific, some topics which are by kind of where people join them in a biased way. And so you will get different correlation in different parts, or it can depend on the societies or whatever. And so what they propose is to study this in more details using some multi-scale assortativity. So I don't go into the details here, but just to give you this this idea. So for instance, they start by plotting the distribution of the local assortativity. So the local assortativity means I take one node, I compare with the one which are connected to it directly, and this tells you something about that node. So if this node is connected to people with the same attribute, then for this node there is assortativity. But then if another one is connected to nodes with a different value, then this node is disassortative. And so we plot the distribution, and so you can see that in this graph, for instance, some parts is completely orange and another one is completely blue. So what you get is that many, these ones are all assortative. So you get many nodes which are completely assortative. And then in another part of the network, it's completely random. People do not have any preference. So you have some completely disassortative relation. Not random. It's really a disassortative. So you see from this distribution that it's very biased, like either you are assortative or you're disassortative. And the property is that all these graphs here, they have been constructed to have exactly the same assortativity, global one. So the global assortativity, if you compute it as I explained it before, you get, I think, zero in that case. Well, actually, I know that it's the same, but yeah, it should be zero in average. So if you compute it as I've defined it before, you will say no, there is no assortativity in none of these networks. But if you look at the details, yes, you see that in some of them, so the distribution are very different. So some of them, like this one, are really picked around zero. So all the nodes are kind of not interested by the attributes of other nodes. And in this one is really like either you like, you love, or you dislike. So and they define it then in the example, it's at distance one, but then they do it for other distances and they kind of get some sense of how it's distributed studying this, but you can check details. But just to tell you that, be careful, like in every time you study data, if you just look at the mean, and you make some conclusion about that, well, be careful, because the mean, you can have like values on every value is on minus one or one, and your mean is zero. So sometimes when you don't want to just speak about assortativity or not, you can think in terms of mixing patterns. So mixing patterns means what is the correlation between one nodes with one type and what nodes with another type. So for instance, here you have in a social network the matrix of correlation between age. And what you can observe is that it's not as simple as people get connect with similar people. If it was the case, you will have red, so strong values on the diagonal. You will have so if it's perfectly associative, you will have just a straight line on the diagonal. Otherwise, you could have some red in the center of the diagonal, and then a little bit like it's here, red, and then some orange, and then some green, and nothing outside of the diagonal. But it's not what you observed here. You observe that there is some pattern clearly of correlation like this. And why is that? Well, because here you see that it's around 30 with approximately zero, and then it moves like this. So clearly this corresponds to parent-child relationship in that case. So whatever this, how this social network has been built, but it captures this. It captures that people, well, are very close from very strongly connected, related to their children until age 50, maybe, and then the connection kind of disappear and maybe reappear later. So if you remember the first class, I had shown you this plot, if you remember. So each line corresponds to one age. So the blue one corresponds to the distribution, the fraction of age of the neighbors of nodes of age 30. And I was telling you that, yeah, it was picked around 30. And now you can interpret this and say, yes, so there is some homophily in that graph. So that's how we can formulate it now. There is one particular case of assortativity for homophily. Actually, when in a paper people use assortativity just like that, they say there is an assortativity in the graph of, and they don't really talk about attributes before. It means degree assortativity. So it means that the attribute they are considering is not some external attribute. It's an external, which is a property of the graph, which is the degree of the node themselves. So basically the idea here is to see if nodes with a high degree, they tend to be more connected with other people with a high degree. And so it's really a similar notion. And doing this, they compute it like here, and they you see that some kind of networks, they have some degree assortativity, and otherwise on the contrary are disassortative. Like biological tend to be disassortative in that case. Well, the one they have chosen, of course, it's not true of all networks. And social ones maybe are more assortative, but it really depends, of course, on what you're looking at. But here we are not talking about attributes, but really about degrees. Another notion that we can say, yeah.
The last column.
I don't remember this one. Sorry. The question was, what is the error column? I don't remember. We have to check the paper. So the reference is here. So another way to interpret this correlation is to look at the average nearest neighbor degree. So here I call it like this, KN, so average nearest neighbor degree. And it can be written in that way. So I won't go back because I introduced this, I think, briefly when we were talking about the configuration model. And we said that we have shown that the average nearest neighbor degree can be written in that way. And since it can be written in that way, you see that what is expected if the graph is random, with an hetero, and you know the distribution of degree, is that the average nearest neighbor degree is constant. It does not depend on on the degree of knots. And so if the network is assortative, you will have a positive function, a positive relationship. And if the network is disassortative, you will have a negative function. And so this is what you observe if you plot this graph, in which you have a co-ordinative network with here the degree of knots, and here you have the average degree of neighbors. So the nearest neighbor here, and then is nearest neighbor. And what you see is that if you have dots like this, then you have you see that there is a slope like this, a slope which is positive, which is you have this relation in this sense, and this tells you that yes, there is some assortativity in that case, but it's a little bit more. You can say a little bit more than just there is assortativity. You can say yeah, for nodes of, so what you would expect by chance would be this. If the network was random, you will get this. So you can say that. So this nodes with a given degree or a degree of 100, they are more likely to be connected to degree. They have a higher average degree of neighbors than expected, much higher. And this relates to what we have discussed before about in this case, it's a little bit different. So of course, if it's disassortative, you get the opposite. You get a slope which is negative. So you can draw these plots. And this should remind you also of a plot I shown in the first class, which was this one. And on this one, I told you, we can see that we have this friendship paradox, in which the average degree of your neighbors is higher than yours. And now you can see that there are two effects in it. Because if the network were random, you will have a straight line like this. This will be the straight line. If the network was perfectly assortative, you will have this diagonal here. So if you have this diagonal, your friends in average, they have the same number of friends than you, same degree. But you see that, by chance, you can see that by chance, you still have the friendship paradox. You have the friendship paradox because most of the people actually, they have an average degree of 200 or something like that, or in this part of the plot. And so for most of them, you can see that in average, since it's a straight line here, in average, people have more friends than them. Like 200, if it was the same number, if the average degree was the same as the degree of the node, you will be here, but in a random network, you're here. And what you observe when you plot it on the graph is that the average degree of nodes is actually, depending on the degree, is actually like that. So it means that you have this friendship paradox, but maybe it's not as strong as it should be if the network was random. And nevertheless, you're not on this line. So it means that you have some assortativity effect. And this assortativity, you remember I plotted here that nodes with a degree of 50, blue line, they stand to be connected more frequently with people around of age 52. So this is a clear observation of the assortativity. So you have these two effects here, the friendship paradox and in heterogeneous degrees, and the fact that people tend to be connected preferentially to people with similar degrees. A last, so what you can derive from that, so it was clear in the, maybe if you try to interpret in the astrophysics co-authorship network, what this tells you, so co-authorship of papers, so what this tells you is that famous people tend to collaborate more with famous people. Like people who have many collaborations, they tend to have collaboration with more with people with many collaborations too. And so of course, because they have many collaboration, but what this graph tells you is that it's even more than that. And so yeah, just to end up, this leads to another kind of analysis you can do, which is the rich club coefficient. So this is just an idea. I won't go into the details, but basically if you want to study if there is a rich club in your network, so this idea that you have a group of people who are famous, popular, rich, whatever, and they are mostly collaborating, interacting, have a relation together, then you can do something like what is described here, which consists in ranking node by degrees. And then you remove nodes in an ascending degree order. So you remove the small node, and then you continue to you do this. And every time you measure the density of the remaining network. So you kind of look and you compare that with a random network. So you compare what's happening with a random network. If you see that when you do this process, you tend to keep nodes in the network, and when you end up with only the rich, you have a higher density than what you would expect by chance, then it tells you that yes, there is a rich club. So they have done it here, for instance, in some networks. So the straight line will correspond to having an expected number of edges in the graph compared with a random with a null model when you do this process, and you see that sometimes it will be below this line. So it means that you actually have less. So you have the contrary of a rich club. So maybe people who are at the top, so famous, popular, in that case, so by in terms of degrees, they tend not to connect together for some reasons. And in other ones, you will observe that yes, you will have this relation, and you have a stronger this tendency to connect. Yes.
Do you randomly choose the threshold k or
the threshold
k?
Ah, no. The idea is that this k in the algorithm you do it for every k by increasing your k. You start with a small k, and then you increase. Okay, that's why you have k in the figure. Okay, so sorry, it's very small, but the idea is this, that the process is really, I start from k equals zero and have this value, and then I increase my k, and the more I increase, the more I remove the small one, and I see that I have more edges than expected, nevertheless, in the network. Okay, so I think we are good. So I added on the website on the website I added for the project some examples of project. So if you go at the bottom of the website, you will see where I describe the project. You have the link to the description with the PDF explaining the project, and then you have the link to some files of project of last year. I have not chosen like the best one or the worst one or whatever. I just picked the one which were first in my folder. So it's not it's just inspiration. You can look at them and it can give you some ideas. Another thing is about the the presentations that you have to do, the second way to give you marks. I put some links in the Discord. If you don't want to go to the Discord, maybe I will send it back. I will send it today to everyone by email, all those of you who send me the email. The links to PDFs of the proceedings of last year conference on complex networks and application. So you have, I don't know exactly how many, but more than 50, 80 papers. They are relatively short, like it's about 12 pages. And on the Discord too, so I will also send the link to everyone by mail. There is a link to a spreadsheet and a Google Doc in which there are slots and you can put your name in the slots. Please do it by groups of at least two or three, but at least two. Otherwise, I don't have enough slots for everyone because even like this, the slot is very short. It's only 10 minutes. We will do it for the students in computer science, you will do it at the end. So at the end of January, and for the other ones, you will do it at the beginning of January. So you can check the slots that I attributed. You can check that later. And what else? So for the presentation, you need to prepare some slides. And I think the best way is that you send me the slides in advance in PDF so that we don't lose time changing computers between presentations. What else? So yeah, it's very short, 10 minutes, but the articles in the conference I gave you, so in the proceedings, they are short articles. And they are not usually like, if you want to publish a groundbreaking article, you don't publish it in that conference. It's very often more to join together, to discuss about new ideas. So those papers, they are sometimes not, so there are things to critics. That's also part of what I think is interesting. So don't feel free to critique what is in the paper. Yeah, they are often internship student papers or something like that. If you prefer to work on another paper, like you don't find something interesting in it, and you want to know more about community detection, dynamic networks, some neuro paper or whatever, you can choose another paper. You just send me in advance so that I check that it's what I would consider in the scope of the class. But if they like compute some centralities or cluster or communities or if they graph some graph models or whatever, probably I will agree on it. So that's a possibility. So it can be a little bit harder because if you take a paper which is 40 pages long with a lot of new notions in it to submit in 10 minutes, it's hard. But of course, it's also interesting to read. So whatever, you can do what you want. Just ask me before so that I validate it. I also would like that every group choose a different paper. So I ask on the spreadsheet to put the name of the paper you have selected. If someone has the same, you should change. You should pick another one. If you see some interesting paper and you don't have access to it, you can ask me. I will find it and I will give it to you. I don't know what else. Other questions? No. Okay, good. Then you can continue to the experiments. If you, so they are about assortativity.